So there is no infinity here with this earth. So the Book of Revelation will be a global experience, and we're actually going through it right now. We were supposed to have a natural progression of evolvement, and we stopped it.
Imagine if you lived your life based on your grandfather's belief system, or what he knew to be true.
In the words of Jesus, in the words of any of them written in religion, cannot hide the past. We are part of this source, and we are created in its image. The soul is seeing time go by, but it's not actually feeling the time. Knowledge is worth nothing until you experience it.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Vincent Genna. How are you doing, Vincent?
I'm doing great, Alex. Thank you for having me here. This is exciting. I love shows like this.
Oh, I thank you so much for coming on the show, my friend. I've been a fan of yours from a distance for a while. So I've watched your stuff. I've always found you absolutely delightful, and you are hilarious, which I love. The energy you bring to conversations, the energy you bring to your work as a psychic medium, you don't take yourself seriously. In the world of woo-woo, people tend to take themselves a bit too seriously sometimes. So I know a lot of psychic mediums and channelers and so on. But my favorites are the ones that don't take the work. They take the work seriously, but they don't take it seriously. And they don't take themselves seriously. So that's why I love you, and I'm looking forward to our conversation.
Well, I'm looking forward to it, Alex. And you're absolutely right. And I bring humor to my work because there's so much seriousness going on in the world. And mm-hmm. We cannot live life on that level consistently. We need to relax. We need to take life more enjoyably, and as well as see the seriousness of it at times. But humor and that old adage, a teaspoon of sugar helps the medicine go down, from Mary Poppins, right? I love mm-hmm. that, and the kid is still there. Well, I use a gallon of honey to help people get that medicine down, because that medicine is pretty hard sometimes. And the way I deliver it, I have to deliver it with some humor as well to make it easier for them to receive, you know? And mm-hmm. and yet you will not see me walking around with a pyramid on my head. I'm sorry. I am not out in woodland like that, okay?
So, fair enough. So let's go back a little bit, Vincent. Okay. So, I mean, we see this person who has obviously been down this road. You've been in this space for a long time as a psychic and as a medium. But it was always not as open as it is today. That's for sure. Back in the days when right. You probably started, it was a little bit tougher to go down. My first question is, did you always have psychic abilities and saw dead people, as you will, when you were a kid? Or was there a time period prior to that that this kind of just fell on top of you?
Absolutely. This fell on top of me. No, I did not have any of this. I was not the kid that walked into his bedroom and saw an angel sitting at the foot of his bed, Alex. It was usually my mother with a belt or a spoon ready to whack me because I did something, you know, crazy. I don't know. I did, however, in hindsight, as a kid, constantly interject in adult conversations with some kind of information and an answer to one of their questions. And my mother was so embarrassed by that. I was always getting a whack in the head. But my relatives always thought that it was cute and funny. And in fact, my uncle labeled me the little professor because I was walking around with the answers. But the funny thing is that the answers weren't so wrong. They were really on track with things, but I didn't know that as a kid. I just liked talking and being heard. That got me in trouble in school, you can imagine. So no, I did not know any of this until I was 28 years old. And a friend who was originally my enemy in school, because he caused most of my bullying. I was the bullied one. Yes, I was chased every day after school. When they caught me, they beat me up. They shoved me in lockers, flushed my head in toilets, thrown me in dumpsters, de-pantsed me, threw me in assemblies, peed on me, spit on me, all of that stuff. Yes, above all of that. And this guy antagonized it, and he was a class clown and a super jock, so everybody loved him. So all he had to do was mention my name. That was it. I was bullied. But at the 10-year high school reunion, which I went to because it was shortly after I did the movie Grease. I used to be a professional singer, actor, and dancer. You know that. You saw that in my profile there. And so I was kind of like a very the small town famous guy, even though I didn't have a major part in the movie. It didn't matter. I was in a major movie, right? So so this guy befriended me. But at the same time he befriended me, he was the type of guy who did nothing but talk about himself. He even rented the Porsche to impress everybody there. And so you ask him how he was, and he went on and on about his life. And I kept hearing every time he spoke, BS, BS, BS. I didn't know why. Not until after my wife and I actually spent a weekend with him, because he became a dear friend after our reunion. He just wanted to be around me all the time. And he was such a nice guy as an adult. He was jerk as a kid, but he was a great guy. And so after this weekend, we're driving home. He lived in Connecticut and we were living on Long Island at that time. And I was in tears and I cried out. For the first time I ever asked God to help me. I was a recovering Catholic. You know, I married
Same
a Jewish
here.
Woman. So yeah, you would completely understand. And so, we were very spiritual, though, and I still believed in God. And so I was crying out to him in tears, asking him to give me the ability to help my friend, because I knew his life was falling apart and my heart was breaking for him. He was not the type to share that, but something inside of me said something's wrong, desperately wrong. And I didn't know what to say to him. I didn't know what to do for him. I was an actor. Yeah, well, I certainly worked with a lot of people who had emotional problems, you know, as an actor. And I guess that kind of like went from working as an actor to now supporting them and people like them, right, with the emotional issues. But it was within a week of that prayer that I kid you not, the most incredible paranormal thing started happening to me. Even Steven Spielberg and Cecil B. DeMille, for anybody who was old enough to know Cecil B. DeMille and their epic movies, they would have been so proud as to what happened to me. It was a total movie, truly, with spirits showing up in my house and psychics now I'm being introduced to. They're telling me that I'm going to become a spiritual teacher, all this psychic stuff coming to me. I began to channel words coming out of my mouth, downloading like crazy. It all happened within a 3-month period, all of this stuff. Overwhelming completely. My wife didn't know what to do, but thank goodness she had been with me since I was 17 years old. So she knew something was happening. And I was spewing out words of life and what it's all about, the meaning of it, and what God is, and what we are, and what we're supposed to be doing here, and on and on and on and on and on. And so that's how it began for me. Certainly, I was not expecting that. I still wanted to be an actor, and I was bucking it all along the way when it was happening to me, because I didn't want to be a woo-woo psychic. Well, what's that going to do? Put a palm up on the highway, just like Sister Sarah, right? And that you see on the roadway there. What was I supposed to call myself? Brother Vinny? You know, it's just like, or Cousin Vinny. That would have been better. It's just like, yeah, people were going to come for me for a reading. Yeah, you know what I see in your future? You know, what is I going to do? So I didn't want anything to do with that. And but here I am now on your show.
So let me, so I got to ask you though. So, all right. So when this giant amount of information and all of this stuff just happens so quickly, I mean, from other psychics and channels I've spoken to, some are born with it. Some have it gradually happen. Some of it happens and they reject it right away. But it seemed like it came in fast and it came in hot. And it came in pretty much almost, I mean, you lived a lifetime of someone in the olden days, almost 30, people died at 35. So you almost lived a full lifetime before this came into your life. Essentially, you were an adult already. You had already gone through stuff. And I'm assuming you had indications. There were little mysteries that would happen to you, but all of a sudden this opens up. How do you psychologically deal with seeing a dead, like what happened when you first saw your first dead soul, not dead soul, but a soul of a dead person in your room. Like, is that Harry? Harry, are you? Like, how did it go?
Yeah. I love the way you put it, man. Yes, it's like I was going to check myself in at that point. I mean,
Right.
it started just as the psychic part where I was knowing, literally knowing things, knowing about people, knowing about their past, knowing what they were going through, knowing what was going to happen to them, right? All that relevant psychic stuff that goes on. And so, okay, so I couldn't fight that because it was coming in whether I wanted it or not. I wasn't doing anything with it, but it certainly piqued my wife's and my interest. And so we started doing a lot of research. I was being told, because I was going to be a spiritual teacher, that I would constantly be directed. So you were saying earlier that I was having signs. I didn't have any signs of this. Nothing. The most sign I ever had is we had just seen the movie Poltergeist. And I had such an incredible curiosity about that and wanted to know about ghosts. And I wound up having an out-of-body experience and went to a haunted house where these evil spirits were coming after me. That was before all of this happened. And that was totally as a layperson, not knowing what was going on there, right? And then my wife started picking up books like The Material of Seth. And she was getting really interested in that. So it wasn't a noticeable sign. It was a draw in a direction without us knowing. And let me tell you, I'm from a small town, Levittown, Long Island. My wife is from East Meadow. We had a small town mentality as far as worldly knowledge. I didn't know a lot about anything in the paranormal other than what I was seeing in California when I was living there and working in the movies. You know, the psychics there. Magic Castle and the shows that they put on over there, that kind of stuff. But other than that, and the movies, The Exorcist, you know, that was about it. Just like mainstream people, that was the only thing that we were ever involved with. And not like what everybody else was involved with. So, yes, when this hit me, it was a whirlwind of stuff, but the interesting thing is, this is what my wife and I did because of all this information coming to me, is we went to a bookstore. And, you know, back in those days, the spiritual section was the occult section. Oh, man, we're in the bookstore, local bookstore, and we're looking around. Nobody sees us. And we're walking down the aisle because we didn't want anybody that knew us that we were interested in anything like that. And we would randomly pick up books, the teachings of the masters of the Far East, the Bhagavad Gita, and we started roaming through the pages, and all of a sudden we'd stop, and there was a paragraph of words I had said previously. And we kept seeing that, and my wife was seeing that. She said, "You just said this the other day. How did you know that?" I'm like, "Honey, I don't know. You know, I never read any of these books." And so that's when we both said something big is going on here, and something big is going on with me. But why me? Why me? Yes, I wanted to be a professional actor, and I wanted a Tony and an Emmy and an Oscar and all of that stuff. And I was, you know, Hollywood bound and all of that and musical theater, but not psychic stuff, and certainly not being able to give people readings. Then as I started to accept it and study it, that's when I was talking with somebody and I'm looking and there's a woman standing next to this person. And I'm like, I'm seeing through that person. So that person's not really there. And it was the person who I was talking to, her mother. I was just randomly, it's just like, "I don't know, your mother, you told me your mother is deceased, is gone." "Yeah, she died a long time ago." "Really? Okay. You've been thinking about her lately?" "Yeah, yeah. I just got a feeling that you were thinking about her lately." "Really? And you just kept feeling like she was around you or something?" "Yeah, yeah." "Well, good, because she's standing next to you right now." And it was freaky. It was weird. Mm-hmm. Again, with every step that happened to me, I didn't know how to accept it. I didn't know if I was making it up because I was now getting into this grandiose business, you know, just like it's just like, and you've experienced it. It's just like actors. It's just like the entertainment world. You know, it's now because it becomes so widely known is everybody is coming out of the woodwork. And at that time, for me, it was beginning. Shirley MacLaine, this is what normalized my experience. Shirley MacLaine did on the Oprah Winfrey Show one afternoon. I was watching. I was home babysitting my 2.5-year-old son while my wife was at work. Because as an actor, you were home a lot at the time. You know that. I know what your experience was. And I'm watching the show, and she comes on, and she's talking about Out on a Limb and what her experiences were. So it was the first time somebody famous, somebody well-known came out of the spiritual closet. And that's what was happening for me, to let me know that what I was going through was being normalized now. So it started to come out, Alex. And but I was still resistant of becoming that spiritual teacher. What did that mean? I was going to change the lives of people. That's a big responsibility. I didn't know if I wanted that. And then as I was starting to see the deceased people, dead loved ones, it just appeared, just be in my mind, and a knowing and a feeling and a smelling and a hearing. It just was very strange for me. It was very strange for me, but somehow I wanted it so desperately.
Right.
I couldn't believe that it was me. I kept turning to God. And that was what I was being told, is that the soul of Jesus was around me and that he was starting the whole thing for me. And I'm like, the soul of Jesus? Did he know that I was an altar boy and that I was eating his body and drinking his blood before Mass in the back of the rectory, and he still wants to work with me?
I gotta tell you, those crackers were amazing. I remember those crackers. I always said, I was like, you know, Mom, can we just buy them? Like, they're delicious.
I love them. I still do. And if there is some kind of cracker that I find today, it brings back the memories of those delicious, the wafers, I call them.
Yeah,
right?
The wafers.
The host. And they were coming in a big giant box.
Like, where can we buy these? I'm assuming Amazon has it now. I'm assuming we can buy it on Amazon.
Any minister can get them now. I'm sure of it. Yes, absolutely. So, yes. But let me tell you, I am still amazed when I do my work. Chicago Television, there was a television show, and you've seen that on my website, that brought me in. And the producer was a historian of the area. And so what we did, he thought it was a great idea, bring me in. And we used to go to the haunted sites, the most haunted sites in Chicago. Sure. But I pick up, film it, and then we do an episode on TV. I cannot tell you some of the experiences that I had, that I walked away. And I'm talking about validating experiences. Sure. I would talk about, like, I went to the Civil War. There was a Civil War battleground, and actually a prisoner of war camp, one of the biggest at the Northern Camp, Camp Douglas in Chicago. It housed 33,000 Confederate prisoners that died all over the place of all different things. So, of course, the place is haunted. The cemetery was haunted. So I go there, and all of a sudden, the spirit introduces himself to me. It was a Civil War Confederate soldier. He's talking to me, giving me all this information, telling me his name, his family background, yada, yada, yada. And the producer that night winds up finding him. And every single thing I said was in black and white writing. And they showed it as a surprise. He shows it to me on the episode the next day. That's when we shot it in the studio. And the hosts were like, well, we got a surprise for you. And they bring up, and I'm like, oh my gosh, you mean that was true? So it flipped me out. I still get flipped out, Alex, over these things. I even saw a Roman soldier when we visited Italy, right? And he's standing next to me on a hill. I'm by myself at night overlooking the Colosseum. He's standing there, and I'm like freaking out. I'm like, are you real? This is the oldest spirit I had seen. Why are you hanging around here for so long? Oh, I was deemed as a traitor. My family was, suffered, blah, 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 blah. He gives me his name. I go back to the van with my wife, and I look up the name. I Google it, and he's there He's there. And so that's the kind of thing that still freaks me out. It's like, I'm legitimate. I'm like, I'm so surprised. I get off the phone with clients and I tell my wife, you are not going to believe what I just saw for this person. And it was real. And it surprises me all the time. It's all the time. I don't know about the other psychics and the other mediums, but I'm still surprised as to the mysticism of this. And I like that. I don't want to lose it.
Let me ask you a question, because that Roman, the Roman ghost, if you will, I guess it's a ghost. We call it or
ghost,
a spirit.
It was a ghost, yeah.
It's a ghost. So the concept of the afterlife and reincarnation and multiple lives, if that soul is still hanging out in the Roman mask in that lifetime, has that soul moved on and this is just a segment of his soul? Or is he just literally sitting there in limbo until he decides to, like, find the light and move on? And then we can get into the quantum physics of it all, that all lives are happening at the exact same time. Future, there is no past, there's no future. So we can go down that road as well. But I'm just curious your perspective from what you do.
It's really interesting that you ask that, but nobody has ever asked that before. They are stuck here. The soul is stuck here. The essence that incarnated, you are an essence of your oversoul, your higher soul that is on the other side. And we can talk about a couple of your other buddies or girlfriends up there that were you in past lives. Okay.
That we'll is talk about up that. There.
We will definitely get there. But right now, this is the essence of you that's going on. Mm-hmm. If you do not cross over, if you don't go through that tunnel of light, which is an express train, actually, it gets you through the earthly dimensions into the heavenly dimensions. There are several earthly dimensions. We're in the third, living in the third in the physical plane. There's the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, right? So they are here. That soul stays here. It does not incarnate again. It cannot incarnate again until it gets to the other side again and then decides from that point on what other experience it wants to have. But for now, it is stuck here. That is why every single culture has some kind of honoring the dead, pray for the dead, limbo, purgatory. That's what Catholicism taught us. Where was limbo? Where was purgatory? Well, now as a medium and a psychic, I understand where it is. It is right here in these earthly dimensions, and they are ghosts. Now, there is no hell other than what we experience for ourselves and create for ourselves, but there is that area. And so, no. The soul does not go on. You cannot communicate. A medium can only communicate with that soul as it's here in the earthly dimensions, not because it's in the heavenly dimensions at all. So it's kind of frozen. Okay. But as you had said, the past, present, and the future are all having happening at the same time. But in those dimensions, there is no time. So therefore, the soul is seeing time go by, but it's not actually feeling the time. It's just going past as if it's thumbing through a history book, and it's just going right through. And if there is somebody that has their senses open that winds up picking them up, they stop at that moment. They stop. They can communicate. They can identify. They also can get angry. They can get frustrated, and that's where your hauntings or your supposed poltergeists come in play, because misery enjoys company. And if they can make you scared and if they can make you feel bad, then they feel good too, you know, about that. So it's like the water cooler effect. You know, you go there and a couple of employees are hanging around the water cooler and start complaining and feel misery. Then another person comes in and they wind up picking up the feeling. They join in, and maybe there's one that's instigating even more so. That's exactly what happens with those spirits when they hang around here, because they are frustrated. The only ones who can help cross them over are the living, the incarnate ones, because those are the only spirits those spirits see. They do not see the other guides and angels and source and deceased loved ones. They can't see it in that dimension. We can only see them. They can only see us. And we're the only ones who can help them cross over by prayer, by wishing them well. And that's what I did all the time when I went. When I go ghost busting, I don't go ghost busting. I go to find them and then do everything I can to help cross them over.
But Vincent, are they fractals of the Oversoul? Because you said the Oversoul. So the Oversoul is the, I call him the game player. And we're multiple video games down here, and they're the game player playing the game, if you will. That's just my little analogy. So is that specific incarnation a fractal of the Oversoul, which is of course a fractal of Source, and as a general statement, and that Oversoul is still having other experiences in other time periods? That's, I just want to clarify that from your point of view.
Yes, that, okay. We can do it one of two ways. And it is, this is legitimate question that you have. Again, that's smart enough to be able to ask that, because it's rare that anybody even talks about that. Okay, we can come down as one fraction of that Oversoul, okay? Mm-hmm. Or we can decide to, at the same, in the same time period, come down in two different pieces, and one is on one side of the world, one's over here. So in other, and that's kind of where the concept of twin souls came up, but there really is no such thing as a twin soul. There's just another part of you that you created to experience life at the same time. So now you're experiencing twice as much. So the idea is you evolve twice as fast. The whole idea is about evolving. That's it. Now, as far as incarnating in different time periods, yes. Again, remember, there is no such thing as time to the Oversoul. So whenever it sent down a fraction of you at another time period, the fraction doesn't know that. Only the Oversoul is. And the Oversoul is not playing several games at one time. Okay. It's only playing one game at a time, or two games at a time, a human time. So, so therefore, it, its experience is just of this time period. Now, it may have had one or two in a past time period of an earthly time, or before that, or they may have more in the future. But it's really not doing it all at the exact same time, because then the Oversoul would not be able to control exactly, and it actually doesn't control anymore. Once we're here, we're controlling it. It doesn't, it feeds us information if we're willing to accept it, but we are not being manipulated by it, right? So when you think of this as the game player, but once the game starts, it no longer is the player.
It's the viewer.
It's all feeding the information. We are the players now.
Yeah, the Oversoul essentially is watching the game. It's watching the game.
Yes.
Yeah, I've used the term that we are essentially the algorithm of God. Once the algorithm is let loose, what the algorithm does, we have a kind of an idea, but it really can go off left to right and grow in multiple different ways. We're kind of like that algorithm. And then we can get into the soul blueprint. So when we do come down as the soul, we do have things that we want to achieve in this life. So in this life, you came down, you're like, look, you're going to be in Greece. Fantastic. You're going to want to be an actor, but you're really not going to do that for a long time in the scope of your life. We're going to throw you into the psychic thing because you want to learn that. You want to experience all of that, want to help, you want to do all that. And that's part of your souls. Just like me, I started off as a filmmaker and then now I'm a podcaster, for God's sakes. It's ridiculous.
Right. Oh, yeah.
But those skill sets apply to this world now as your the information that you did in your first 28 years has definitely helped you in this line of work. Would you agree?
Without a doubt, Alex, it actually led me. And it's the whole reason why I can stand on stage. I look towards the time where I can be in a stadium filled with 85,000 people. And I know I can handle it because I did when I was younger, and I had them, I was able to get them in the palm of my hands as an actor and control their emotions, make them laugh, make them cry. But now I have their souls in my hands and I can feed them information that helps wake up the information and the knowledge within them. Because that's truly what we're here to experience. You know, it's interesting that we're fractions of, actually, the way you said it, and I say it another way, the way that Source God created us was by taking a piece of itself and dividing it into us. That's why we are part of this source and we are created in its image. Okay. So we are, you know, ourselves, individual God. And collectively we are God, but then there's also still God as well. That's my perspective of God and Source. And we have the ability to use that power and use all the knowledge that came with the creation. But here's the thing is that knowledge is worth nothing until you experience it. And as Edgar Cayce, which I was directed to and did all the study work on Edgar Cayce material, and actually then 33 years later became one of the speakers for an event there, which I was so excited to do, right? And he had said that our goal is to get to know what we know. And what he means by that, by consciously knowing and experiencing what we unconsciously and superconsciously know in our soul, because then that's when we get to own it and understand, wow, I'm on this unlimited being. I'm this divine creator of my own life, and we can affect each other. And this is wonderful. And it's great. These are my brothers and sisters. And it's all about getting to that point. But the problem is that things became blocked once we got here because we have been off track for the longest time. As a matter of fact, the time period from the beginning of the Bible and Adam and Eve, which, by the way, is a different version of man and when man started, was only one lifetime. All, everything we have written in history right now and what we know about history is only one existence on this planet. There were other ones and other civilizations before this planet. And stop it was still it. Us coming down
stop
here.
Stop it. Stop it, Vincent. Okay? Stop it. You're such a bad Catholic. You're a bad Catholic. No, I'm sorry.
Aren't I a bad Catholic? I'm terrible Catholic. But there was a reason for that. Because Catholicism, if you think about it, everything was created for a reason, right? We understand it. And most people are incorrect as to why they created it. They really did not create religion to control us. They created religion because these people knew, the souls knew that there's a whole bunch of young people on this planet and they need guidance. And it was always that parental thing. We're going to guide. We're going to help. We're going to protect you. We're only going to feed you the information we think you can handle. That's even how our government has worked. Yes, are there the power-hungry people? Always. But that was not the original reason for creating it. Well, there was a reason why we created Genesis and the Old Testament as we know it today, because we were trying to make it concise, a concise civilization, so that people weren't sitting there thinking about all the other civilizations that preceded this one. And it's all evidence of that throughout the Bible, because they can't hide everything. They can't hide it all. In the words of the leaders, in the words of the prophets, in the words of Jesus, in the words of any of them written in religion, cannot hide the past, right? Even in Judaism. But they try to make it so simplified for us. Just listen and believe this, and maybe you'll get on track.
But Vincent, that was of service to humanity at a certain time in history. Mm-hmm. There was a moment in time when everyone was raping and pillaging and killing people and doing things, and they needed some sort of rule book for society to make sense. And then also the afterlife and all this stuff. But this has been going on before. It happened with the Egyptians. It happened with, you know, everyone within the last 10,000 years before the Younger Dryas came and all the other civilizations that perished before then. All of this stuff was needed. But I have a feeling that we don't need it anymore. And that's kind of what is happening throughout this, throughout humanity right now, where you and I, you know, we're not, we're of similar vintage, not the same vintage, but similar vintages. So you and I have definitely, and I was in New York for almost 10 years. So we've definitely walked over the same dead bodies, no pun intended.
I know.
Have similar shrapnel. But when we were growing up, and I pick on the Catholic Church because we're both ex-Catholics, so we could do this. They were an institution that was infallible. When we grew up, the Catholic Church was this monumental giant, the Vatican. Nothing could happen. It's perfect. It is the word of God. That's what we were told. Where nowadays, the cracks have definitely been showing over the last 40 years on the Vatican and in the Catholic organization, not the religion, but the organization. And then all of these cracks have been happening throughout all the major religions around the world. And people are starting to go, this just doesn't make sense anymore. You know, like I remember my mom wanted to go to church when I was getting communion for the first time. And they're like, you can't go because you're divorced. And she's like, what? Like, you can't receive the communion because you're divorced. I'm sorry. So these are the things that didn't make sense anymore. And you can start seeing the fractionalization of all of this happening, so to the point now where people are not religious anymore. They're spiritual and they're searching for information, like from these shows like this, books like that. And they're looking for knowledge that is making sense to them at a soul level, feeling it. And they're not running on fear of religion. They're running on other type of fear, but not on this kind of fear. Does everything I say make sense to you?
Okay, it makes 100% sense. And I'm going to even bring it down to another form. Didn't you have the same feeling about your parents? When you were growing up,
absolutely,
the exact same thing. What you're giving an example of in religion-wise, you can now hold as a sampling of everything in the way we learned, right? And here's the problem with humanity. This has been the problem, which is why we're getting advanced societies and beings of a higher consciousness coming and visiting us to try to hasten our evolvement here, because we're taking so friggin' long to change our attitudes, right? Mm-hmm. We still have in the Bible that you should stone your wife if you find out that she's not a virgin. That is still written in that book.
Okay, among other things.
Among the other ridiculous things, right? But here's the point. Even our parents will say things when we're children and have these rules that are absolutely ridiculous and almost impossible to adhere to because of who we are as children growing up and everything we want to experience and our own mind developing, right? And so we learn, wait a minute, my parents were fully... You know, it's just like, what? Holy crap. And I'm like, that was wrong of them to teach me that, because this is the better thing. Here's the problem. That would have happened naturally. We were supposed to have a natural progression of evolvement, and we stopped it because we bought into too many other things. We bought into the physicality of this world. So now we were going to pay attention more to the things like money and possessions and protecting oneself, rather than the understanding that we came with, that we don't have to protect ourselves. We're automatically protected because of our belief system, the fact that we are spiritual energy beings. We completely forgot that, but we were down here with that to start with. We understood that, but things began to happen. And then the human mind and the brain, actually, the brain started to get in our way by creating different beliefs. That's what my book is all about, by the way. It's all about the 41 years that I have been working at this. I even went back to school and got my BA in psychology and my master's in clinical social work, because I figured if I was getting inside the deep recesses of the human mind and the psyche, I didn't want to cause it any damage. I wanted to know all about it. So that's why I went back to school. And I understood and learned during that process that, wait a minute, you know, there are different levels of our own mind that the brain created to help us cope now, because we got off track. We no longer had the soul guiding us anymore. So the brain had to take over. And the brain created defense mechanisms, and the brain created these processes that actually got in our way. They're called coping skills, but in fact, these coping skills block out what we really believe about ourselves because the negative messages we receive from the universe now and from all, I'm talking more about the environment that we're in at this time, the adults, the surrounding circumstances, all of that. We developed all these different beliefs that are just deep set inside our psyche, but they're getting in the way of our manifesting. And the brain did that because we forgot. And in that forgetting is when we separated from source, from the God source, and from our own soul, spiritual nature. So that's what we're trying to get to. So yes, then anything that we created, the religions, the guideposts that we created for ourselves in order to help us evolve, they all just got totally misunderstood, misaligned, and out of whack and out of place. Everything was going to go out of balance. Everything. Mm-hmm. Everything that we were thinking we were creating that was good was going to turn out sour because it was coming from an imbalance and a disconnect to start with. And so we did not get to evolve to where we were supposed to be. Go ahead.
What I love about what you said, I never thought about this, but you're absolutely right. And this goes for every aspect of humanity, whether it's healthcare, whether it's education, whether it's all these different institutions. Imagine if you lived your life based on your grandfather's belief system or what he knew to be true. And that was it. Or the great grandfather's belief system or great grandparents' belief systems of what they thought the world was supposed to be and how you dated and how you did all of that stuff has evolved generation after generation after generation. So my generation is a little bit more evolved than my parents' generation. I'm hoping my children they already seem to be more involved than we were at that age. So it seems like it's going. But when it comes to certain institutions, humanity is not evolving through it. And it's been very painful. Religion is one very big one like that. Healthcare is another one like that. The media is another one. Food and how we handle food. All these kind of different things seem to not be moving along the same way that we naturally move on. So that's a really great point because we do evolve generationally, but we're still talking about stuff that was written 2000 years ago. Now, don't get me wrong. There are things that are written 2000 years ago that are truths that are more aligned with spirit, with the spirit and with the soul and with source. But a lot of these other rules don't make a whole lot of sense anymore.
There's a reason for that. Because what you just described as what did evolve mm-hmm. is the physical aspect of who we are. Mm-hmm. It's the mental aspect of who we are, but it mm-hmm. is not the spiritual aspect of who we are. We have not spiritually evolved enough. Our information out there is now come out, all ancient information, and we've added to that. I mean, the spiritual self-help book business and industry, be it with affirmation decks or even lectures and classes and stuff like that, is a $33 billion a year industry. And that is from several years ago that I took that statistic from. Okay. That's how many, you know, how much information has come out now and how much people have bought it and have it on their bookshelves. Okay. But that's the information. Your luminaries today, your guests will be talking about how all this higher consciousness material is out there and that we have the chance to step into it and that we have that possibility of, we have had that possibility of stepping into that knowledge, Alex, since we came down here. Mm-hmm. Okay. But the reason why we are not stepping into it is because we have forgotten and we truly don't believe. Here's the thing. People don't believe what they think they believe. That's the other part. That's the premise of my book and my work. And so what happens is they want to buy into that information and that consciousness. But when they go home and they're still living in their own lives with stress and strain and illness and financial difficulties and relationship difficulties. It's really hard pressed for them to remember that they're those spirits, right? We're still fighting to prove to the world that gays are equal and they have just as much right and they're normal beings, that blacks are normal beings, that women have equal rights, that it doesn't make a difference what religion you practice. We are still fighting that stuff, that spiritual stuff. That's a spiritual understanding. It has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with acceptance of who we are as beings. And we still can't get there. But we got the thin iPhones and we got that. That's going to be really great. And we're improving our technology constantly. And Albert Einstein said that. Albert Einstein said, when your technology surpasses your spiritual evolvement in order to handle it, society is going to be in trouble. And that's exactly where we are today and what you're seeing happening all over the world. Now, I'm not Debbie Downer here, but we just talked earlier about devastation that's gone on recently and how there's going to be more devastation. Every time there is a battle, there is a killing, there is a bomb dropped, there is a racism. There are people lashing out and hurting other people, either verbally or physically. You are going to see the demise of this planet because we have dominion over it. And our energy supersedes the energy of the planet and feeds into it and literally exacerbates everything that's going to go on here. And that's because we've not grown spiritually. Now, do we have a chance? Yes. You're a blessing. You're a blessing because your program gives people the opportunity not only to listen, but when somebody like myself will say, don't just listen to us talking here. You've got to do the work. You've got to do something about it to recreate your life. And that is the healing of the world. That's what I'm talking about. And there's where the evolvement is going to come. It doesn't matter what was written in the past. It doesn't matter other than you being able to take some of that wisdom and using it today, walking your talk, not just talking it, walk it, not just reading it, walk it. And there's the difference. There is the difference, you know? Yes, we evolved as far as the way we want to live our lives based on what our parents were experiencing when they were kids. And I'm hoping that we do. Some, just so that you know, some don't. Some are still living the lives of their great-great-great-great-grandparents. Oh. And that's why they're, because they know nothing else to believe in, right? So many people will just follow the beliefs of others that have been out there because they don't have any beliefs of their own or sense of themselves.
Well, it's easier.
It's easier only because they have nothing else substantial. When you believe in yourself, you automatically open the channel to internal guidance and to the BS, of the world. You become very discerning. Self-love, self-beliefs expands your understanding. And so when you have that, then all of a sudden you're listening to stuff and you're not going to follow it because you're going, that doesn't resonate with me, because you're waking up all that inner knowledge that we came with. But it has to start with that self-belief so that when that information comes from within, you trust it. And when you're listening to somebody else who's saying something completely off, you're going, I don't trust that.
But that is what's happening now. That is what's happening around the world right now. People are starting to see this. They're starting to feel it's wrong. They're seeing it in their politicians. They're seeing it in their institutions. They're seeing it within their own families. They're seeing it within their own work. They are waking up. Now, is it as much as I would like? No, but it is happening. This show is an example of that. We've been downloaded 170 million times. That means that there's 170 million people or close to it who are interested in these ideas. This was unheard of 10 years ago. The show wouldn't have gone 10 years ago. And I'm not the only. There are multiple shows like ours who are doing this kind of work that people are really searching for. And imagine a show like this in the 80s. It would have been on an AM show at midnight. And that would have been the end of it.
I definitely agree with you. But the one thing I do want to say to that, okay, is yes, people are listening for it because and they're starting to not like, but here's the point. Why did it have to get to the point of them finally saying that I don't like that? You see what I'm about ready to say is they've been so blind and non-accepting that it got this far. Now, do I trust that just because they're listening to us, things are going to change? No, I don't trust that. No,
I agreed.
I don't, because they let it come this far. Okay, so. Everybody loves a novelty. And you can see that. That's the reason why there are so many different religions. There were only a couple of them in the beginning. But the novelty wore off of that religion because it wasn't working the same way. In our field, in my field of metaphysics, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. There was one method of healing, Reiki, that came out. How many methods are there today? Go to an expo. You'll see every single booth is a new method between the crystals, between the colors, the aromatherapy, because it becomes a novelty. Mm. And so during the novelty time, everybody is excited. And so, yes, this spiritual information has been coming out and people are getting more and more excited about it. Oh, wait. There's a new novelty coming along. What is that new novelty now, Alex? Oh, my God. Now we can talk with extraterrestrials. Holy moly. It's acceptable now. New novelty. Again, is this novelty going to wear off? Is it going to do anything? There's only one way to know that this is working, and that is the outcome of the world, the Earth. The Earth is your primary source of seeing if everything is working. And critical mass is the understanding of that. That was the story of Sodom and Gomorrah, and that's the reason why they wrote it in the Bible. It wasn't about God destroying a city. He didn't have anything to do with it. It didn't have anything to do with it. It was the negativity that was going on there, and the message was your own negativity can create such chaos and trauma that you can wind up destroying yourselves. So we're seeing that exactly today.
So that, Vincent, happens to us in our own lives. So I don't know about you, but I've gone through points in my life that I've gotten so bad that I've gotten so off course that it got bad that I had to make a change. Well, as humanity, we're going through that too. And I think, and I want to hear your opinion of where we're going in the next 5 to 10 years, because I think it's going to be a really interesting and crucial time for us. But I believe that we're going to get to a point, and please tell me what you think. I think we're going to, and I think we're getting to it now. You're seeing it in Hollywood, which I want to talk to you about. You're seeing people aren't tuning into Hollywood the way they used to. They're turning off the news media because they're not trusting it anymore. When I grew up, the news media was infallible. Now, no one trusts it because of all these things. So all of these things are starting to happen. Now there's wars, ancient freaking wars that are still going on, ancient ideas that are still being brought back up, which is ridiculous. I think it's going to get, we still, for whatever reason, I think we're just stubborn as a species. It has to get so damn bad for us to go, wait a minute, we don't like this. We won't allow this to happen anymore. We're going to make a change. Now, we've seen bits of that throughout history. World War II was a very big one. We all stopped and said, no, we're not going to allow this to happen. We need to step in, and the whole world got together. It was that was one moment I'm thinking of. But there were moments like that throughout history that we get to that place that it's just so unacceptable that we have to make a change. I wish we didn't have to get to that unacceptable part. I wish we didn't have to hit rock bottom before we make a change, but it seems to be the theory or it seems to be the path of humanity. These next 5 to 10 years, and I've been saying this, and I've been saying it not as an alarmist, but as a realist, I go, guys, it's going to get a little rougher. It's going to get a little bumpier. We're going to make it out through the other end, but it is apparently something that we need to go through to evolve to a higher place. And this could last.
Okay. Yeah. I just, You just made me go, oh, when you said we need to evolve to.
Yes. So what do you think, sir?
It is a belief, and it's a religion that was created around the belief of suffering, that we need to go through this chaos. Mm-hmm. No, we don't.
Agreed.
We don't need to
go
through it. Hey, no. Good. I'm glad you agree to that. That is excellent. Now, here is my concern about that. You just named several historical things that took place that in the immediate post-crisis, there was harmony, peace, we worked together.
Euphoria, yeah.
Let's jump to present times and let's just use the United States. Mm-hmm. There was an occurrence here on September 11th mm-hmm. that was that we never experienced, one of the biggest crises that the United States after World War II with Pearl Harbor, that mm-hmm. we ever experienced, and people of all races pulled together. Right now in my state, over in Asheville, there's a mixed group of people of all nationalities, races, colors, creeds, all of that. And because of the hurricane devastation of Helene, all right, people are doing nothing. They're helping each other. They're saving each other. They're saving each other. The black man is pulling the white man and his family out from under the rubble. Okay, the gay person is helping and giving whatever, being a paramedic and helping, right? There's even Muslims out there and they're helping. This has happened throughout history. And then Monday morning, everybody goes back to normal. So here's the thing. We can't keep doing that, not because we're going to get tired of it, but our living circumstances is going to get tired of it. Mm-hmm. And it's already gone through that. Actually, people have asked me, is this the apocalypse that's been going on? And in actuality, it's really interesting. If you read the book and you go back, first of all, I believe that the book of Revelation is actually a personal experience. And the seven seals are your seven spiritual centers. Right.
Chakras.
That you have to open up your chakras, that you have to open up to get to your highest level, which finally you're going to experience your own peace of life, your own harmony, your own balance, your own divine magnificence. OK, but it's also whatever we experience individual is also accumulative, which is the reason why we were put together. We came down here together to experience this unity. So the individual experience is also going to be a global experience. So the book of Revelation will be a global experience, and we're actually going through it right now. The seven mm-hmm. seals that supposedly Jesus is opening, we're actually opening. And if you go and you read the horsemen that are coming down, one horseman brings down devastation, one brings down famine, one brings down war, yada, yada, yada. We've gone through six of them already. Mm-hmm. So here's what everybody is asking. The seventh seal, once it's cracked open, is pure peace and harmony, no more tears, no more hardships, no more blood shed, no more anything. It's sheer nirvana. That's mm-hmm. what the seventh seal is all about. Now, if somebody asks me, where will that be? Will that be here on this planet? Mm. Or is it in a new dimension? Mm. And not one, and I do not believe anybody who says they have that answer, because they don't even know on the other side. Because this game can play out further until this planet loses all its resources, which it's look at the way it's responding right now. How much more devastation are we going to create on this planet? How much more? What we keep heating up the weather and the atmosphere. We're not going to exist on this planet. We're going to have to do it elsewhere. We're going to have to evolve elsewhere. So there is no infinity here with this earth. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so there's no infinity with how much longer we have to evolve. But because we're souls, Alex, we can take a lot. We constantly get lemons thrown at us. You know, the saying, whenever they throw a lemon at you, you make it into lemonade. What makes this information that we're receiving now better than the information in the New Age that they received then? That's better than the information that they came down to in this planet. What makes it better now? No, then we stopped listening to bullcrap a long time ago. We just have different kinds of bullcrap now. A television puts it out more. The internet puts it out more. Before that, there was the newspaper. There was flyers handed out. There was word of mouth. And we stopped listening to that. That's how all the other things came in existence. Other civilizations and principles and philosophies came into existence because we stopped believing some old stuff. Nothing is different about our MO. Nothing is different about our MO, okay? Except we want to believe that because there's more out there now and people are wanting to believe, and you're absolutely right, more people are listening to you because they want to hear this really good information out there. But you know what? When science started coming out, all of the societies started to follow science.
Yeah.
And they were putting out more information. Once they got over the fact that the planet wasn't flat and there was more science, oh, wow, that's where we got all our science books from, because people were now following all the science. Mm-hmm. What makes what's happening now any different? Nothing. The proof is in the pudding. And so what we have to say 5 to 10 years from now, I have no idea. All I know is we have to change the path of direction the way we're going now. Now, does it look like we have a better chance? Yeah, maybe it looks like we have a better chance. Maybe. But none of it is a guarantee.
We have to
Nothing
act.
Is a guarantee. Because unless people are changing their lives, unless we stop hearing about the suffering, and let's not even think about the global things, unless the kid stops going into a school and shooting other kids, unless that stops, unless we control guns and come up with better reasons and stop thinking all this political stuff, if you even know today, there is no more politics. It's all human values that are always before us. That and a way that this country evolved to human values, that's all it is, has nothing to do with politics whatsoever. A Democrat, Republican, a liberal, whatever you want to call yourself, that doesn't exist anymore. We think it does, and that's just an illusion. What is really the truth and the value here is human values, human values. And so we can only tell if we are going in the right direction by the outcome. By the outcome. And so that's what I look towards. I look towards. I don't look at the possibilities. I look at the outcomes, because that lets me know that the belief systems are getting better. And until we see really good outcomes, you and I are going to be working our asses off to get new belief systems out there and hoping that they get hooked and you then they bite for it and they're starving for it. Yes, they're hungry for something new. But we've always been hungry and starving. You would think that we're all emaciated spiritually. We are, but it's coming. Can it come? Yes. Is it a definite? No. 5 to 10 years, I have no idea. None. Because I can no longer predict. I give a person a prediction. I have no idea if they're going to be moving in that direction to let that prediction, if it's especially if it's a positive one, work, because as soon as they hang up with me, they can change everything. Somebody else can say something and boom, it's out of them because they don't know what to believe in anymore.
So let's go down that road for a little bit, Vincent. Because a lot of people, when they want to try to debunk psychics or, you know, and or mediums or things like that, which I'm sure you've had plenty of that in your lifetime. From my understanding is when a psychic is getting information from the other side about a person's life, it is an estimation of where the energy is heading towards. It is not a guarantee. Now, there are certain things that are a lot more solidified. So like something like 9/11. When the psychic is like, the chances of it not happening are much less than the chances of it happening, just because of all the energy, the way that specific event was happening. Within someone's life, it's similar. But you're right. If you go, you're going to move to New York, I see you in New York. I see you in Broadway. And I see you, if you go down that, you'll get a Tony in about 3 years. Now, that's one path. You hang up the phone, calls mom, mom, I think I'm going to New York. You're not moving to New York, but I want to move to New York. No. I got you a new job here doing this. And all of a sudden, because of your decision, you go over here and now, oh, psychics are bullshit. So it's an estimation of where you're going on a psychic level. On a medium level, when you're talking to the other side, you're talking to a relative, that's very provable very quickly. It's in the moment. It's right in the now. Does that all make sense? Right.
Oh, totally makes sense. Absolutely. And do you know that in the UK, now I studied over at the Arthur Findlay College of Psychic Sciences mm-hmm. for two different times. I went there for a sure. week in 2 years. And it is against the law in the UK for a psychic to predict anyone's future because wow. of the possibilities that it can cause. I have had so many people call me to either verify or to change some of the negative stuff that other psychics had told them that's going to happen to them. Mm. And that is the reason, because you can actually cause a change in a person's future.
Oh, yes.
You can cause damage by what you tell a person about their future. So mm-hmm. when I talk to a person and I talk about their past, and there's a reason. I'm actually teaching the classes right now, and I tell people the reason why a psychic taps into the past is, why do I need to tell you about something you already know that happened? Well, it shows that I'm having a link, that I have a link to you, and that I'm actually connected to your information. All mm-hmm. right. Then when I tell you and give you the message of what's meant to help you in this lifetime, it's going to be more valuable, more credible, because you know, oh, wait, they already gave me some really true information about what I've been going through, so this must be real, you know? And it's not just, I don't just give about the future. I actually help people because of the psychotherapy part of me. You can say I'm both psychic and psycho. and a therapist there, Alex, in helping people to change their current life, right? Their current life. Mm-hmm. And then I tell them, and if you change this, you will be able to attract in a relationship because I see the possibility of that happening for you. As a matter of fact, I even have a description as to how, when, and where it's going to happen. But that is completely going to be determined on you. You are in control of this. So when we hang up, you don't have to believe anything that I say, but one of the things you want to try to do is always try to improve yourself. And if I've given you information to help you with that, then do that. So be it. Because I see that when you were younger at 4 years old, that's when dad left and just never bothered to be in touch with you anymore. So you have a hard time because that hurts so much. You're carrying that scar, and I'm seeing that scar interfere in your relationships today. That's how I do my work. Oh, by the way, dad is deceased now, and he just stepped in, and you have his pocket watch, right? You kept that gold pocket mm-hmm. watch because you love that. Yeah, he's showing me that as a piece of evidence that it's him. And he's also talking about the time that he taught you how to do. You did snowboarding, he's saying that he taught you. He went skiing and he taught you how to snowboard because you wanted to do it differently. Oh, and yes, okay, that. Well, he is apologizing. He's saying he's so sorry for what had happened. So now, as a medium, the only reason why I'm doing that, and not to entertain, I'm huffing and puffing about that, you know, because, and I know, and I don't want to say anything, because I'm sure that you either had them on or will have them on as guests at some point, but whatever is, mm-hmm. is I need that information that they're giving to help the person not just come to closure, not just to cry, oh, my daddy's here, oh, that's so nice and that's so good. No, to help you change things for yourself now so that you can create the life you want. And if it helps you to understand that it wasn't your fault, that daddy is admitting the issues that he was dealing with at the time, and that he is so sorry. Yes, everybody is saying they love you, they love you, they love you, but that's not what's healing. because we want to know, are you sorry? Was I really a good son? Was I really a good partner or a good daughter, you know, to my father, or to my boyfriend, my girlfriend, my husband, my wife, my son that's on the other side? Was I good enough? And you are you sorry for the way you hurt me? That's what they want to know, because that's what they're carrying with them. Not just the fact that they're there. That's how I use my psychic abilities and my mediumship abilities, is to be able to help you change and believe in something more than you're believing in yourself. That's my primary thing, is believing in yourself. That to me is the heat that causes all the ingredients to turn into what you want. You know, if you want to bake a cake, you can get, you know, the greatest ingredients and use your Rachel Ray, you know, utensils and bowls and Pampered Chef Baker to bake that cake. And you're mixing it all up and you stick it in the oven. But unless you've done something first, and most importantly, you will never turn those ingredients into the cake you want. And what is the first line of instructions of every baking recipe or cooking recipe? Preheat the oven. Well, the preheat, the oven, the heat is the process that turns the ingredients into what you want. And the self-belief is what turns all of this work, all of this that you're listening to, into fruition. That's what then, when you heal yourself, where everybody is talking about this group effort, this group effort, this group effort. No, we don't have to focus on the groups. We have a million and one groups out there. Trust me, I'm a social worker. Social workers keep creating groups and organizations and agencies and dividing a piece of the pie. We don't want more groups. We want the individual healing. That will automatically extend out onto the group when you have the individual healing. And you know, the old, I love sayings because they always come from something ridiculous. There is no I in we. Well, of course, there's no I in we. You spell it with a W and an E. Okay. That's number one. Number two, there is no we without an I. So what are you talking about? You can't have a we without more than with just one person. That starts with one person, then it turns into two and three, and now you've got a we. But it always starts with the one. That's what we need more than anything else, is self-healing.
So Vincent, how do you bring in the concept of past lives into this? Because you're talking about current stuff now, and maybe something that happened in your life, like let's say in the person's life. But you mentioned a little bit earlier about some past lives that I had. I would love to hear if you could show me what, not only if you know for fun, what those were, but also how are those affecting my evolution right now, as an example of how you use that information.
Oh, it's interesting. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is the reason why we don't focus on more than one life at a time, because each life that we come into is winds up being an accumulation of our other lifetimes. Because as you come down here, you decide what you want to take with you. You also will change your orientation. By the way, you are a hot chick in a past life. I got to tell you that. definitely over where there was a lot of sand. I'm seeing a lot of chiffon on you. So you were kind of like part of a sheik's, you were a sheik's daughter in a tent. Mm-hmm. So there was a wealth. There was a certain amount of wealth that you had. And there was a certain amount of understanding that you had back then. And because you were pretty, people would come to you and talk with you. Now, usually back in that time period, the women were very protected, especially of a sheik, especially of somebody that had any wealth of that time period, right? But you were a little definitely rebellious. You definitely wanted to get out into the world. You know, what's really funny, that what they're showing me right away is the movie Aladdin. And the cartoon Aladdin, and like you were princess, but you weren't of royalty, but you were definitely of a higher level. But you were like that. You were like Jasmine. You had to get out into the world. You wanted to go amongst the people, right? And you would talk with them, even though they really, you would hide yourself and stuff like that. And so it's what really interesting in this lifetime. You brought some of that with you, though you're not as shapely. I have to say, you're a lot hotter than.
I agree. I appreciate that, sir. I appreciate it. I'm working on it, sir. I'm working on it.
No. You are a very attractive man. But the thing was, you wanted to do it as a man this time. And you wanted to be out there in the face of people. And you wanted to be, certainly did not want to hide yourself, which is what is really interesting that may have led you into the movie industry, because you can't hide yourself there. Maybe you think you're hidden behind the camera, but you're not, or as a crewman or anything like that. You're still known, you're still seen, you're seen by everybody else, and there's still a networking that's going on, right? So you still wanted that, but you also kept the voice, which is what led you to now, to be in front of the camera, to be in front of the microphone, because it was important. I'm not going to hide myself anymore like you did back then. So you were able to only reach a few people. You helped the poor. There is certain, you are very altruistic, maybe not did a lot of volunteer kind of time, but you absolutely are a helper. You would open the door for somebody, you would treat somebody to a coffee or something even today, or want to do that. There's definitely that desire in you, because you did that back then, with the understanding that we're here to help each other. But this lifetime, you absolutely wanted to take in that desire, but use it a different way. And here's the interesting thing. You especially decided to do it as a male in this lifetime because you knew you would have an advantage as a male. Back then, you did not have an advantage as a female, which is the reason why you had to do this all in hiding back then. But now, as a male, You are in the open. You're confident as a male, and you don't have the fears of a woman. Okay, You don't have those fears. But the interesting thing is that there was still a certain amount of limitation in that particular lifetime. You don't like being limited, and you don't like being confined, and you certainly do not like rules of a higher archy, and having to go along with that. You want to do your own thing. So in this lifetime, you really, even though you may work for somebody in the past, you had to do the whole reason for your podcast now is so that you don't have to work for anybody. And that matters to you a lot, especially now that you're doing this work. So do you understand where the correlation could be? I'm curious, though, as to when you think of Egypt and the Middle East and those places over there, what is that natural feeling that comes to you about those places?
Oh, it's been a fascination of mine. I'm fascinated by ancient civilizations, ancient history, lost history, all of that stuff. So it's been a dream of mine to go to Egypt for forever. I've been drawn to all ancient sites since I was a kid. So I've always been fascinated. So that's why I have those kind of guests on my show sometimes, because we go down those rabbit holes together. It's something I'm very, very fascinated with.
So you say, understand that because that was a positive life to as much as it could be. You were a sheik's daughter, so you didn't have to worry about wealth or anything like that. It was a comfortable lifetime for you, so you don't mind, and your interest is still there, especially since you brought some of it with you this lifetime. Me, I garlic cloves I wear around my neck about going to Egypt. And the reason being, this is crazy, and I know, but I had to believe this. My original guide, even though Jesus came to a psychic and was telling me that this is the road I was going to take, and I have a great relationship with Jesus as my bigger brother, as well as he's everybody's big brother, right? It wasn't Jesus who really spent a lot of time guiding me. It was Joseph. Joseph from Canaan. Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat Joseph. So when I first got this, I actually was able to, and still do, interpret dreams. And I didn't realize that. I figured that maybe I was getting that influence from Joseph. But it wasn't until about 10 years into this for me that Joseph told me who he really was. Me. It was one of my incarnations, or part of my incarnations. Now, I had, prior to him telling me that, I had done meditations and past life regressions. And the scariest one that I ever had before he told me that was I was some dark young teen boy and I was in a well. I was trapped in a well and I was petrified. And I didn't in that meditation. I don't know how I got in the well. I only experienced being in the well and feeling I was going to die there slowly and being very frightened of that. And it wasn't until he told me that was an incarnation of mine, supposedly, that the pieces came together. And I was like, oh, my God, that was me in the well, that my brothers put me in the well. But I still, even though I wound up, Joseph had power in Egypt at the end there, I don't care about that. I still don't want anything to do with that area, that period. Whatsoever. I have a very negative emotional feeling when I see it and think about it and with what's happened, especially with what's happening over there now. So it's interesting that a lot of our fears and a lot of our talents and a lot of our weaknesses will come from things there and choices we make. We even do make, now I hesitate in using the word choice when I'm about ready to say this, but this is a pre-choice before we get down on this planet. We will choose our orientation because it's a different experience to have intimacy with the opposite sex than it is to have with the same sex. And we want to experience everything. And those that know, and it was very normal back then. It's only considered abnormal today, but it was always very normal. I mean, the LGBTQ community existed way before modern times. It existed way back then. And it was just through experiences, as well as maybe sometimes those that have a difficult time with it within themselves, and not because of society, but within themselves, took too much with them from their past life. So it's more about, oh, I want that talent. Oh, my God. Yes. So I'm coming in. I want to do it as a male this lifetime. But I was a great singer in a past life. I want that. Oh, my gosh. Oh, and I was really sensitive to others. Oh, I want to take that sensitivity. I really cared. And I did appreciate men back as a woman. I want to be able to appreciate women and everything. So I'm taking some stuff from that past life. And then I get here and I realize, wait, why am I in this man's body? I don't feel right in this man's body. Without knowing it consciously, soulfully, I may have taken a little bit more than what I had expected to take. And there is where the tremendous conflict that I'm talking about comes within a person that they don't know, they don't understand. It is very stressful for them. I deal and have dealt with several of my friends and their children because of those circumstances. But that is my way of being able to explain why that happens. It's not just psychological because of here. And everything affects us from our past lives. So that's just one of yours. Yeah, plus I can always get in off camera to tell you one of the other fun ones that you had that's playing around there. You had a good time at some point back in a past life there, a little rebellious, what I'm seeing, rebel. And there also could be a competitive nature in you from that lifetime that I'm looking at right now. If you find yourself sometimes competing, and whether it be sports or betting or playing a game with somebody, and it really means a lot to you or means something to you, it could be because of that particular lifetime that you were involved in. Ancient Greece. Ancient Greece. I'll go back that far for you. So anyway, that's how past lives affect us. And knowing them, can we exist here without knowing our past life? Yeah, we've been doing it for 11,000 years. We purposely don't remember a past life. But if we do have some trauma that's going on, if we can't get rid of certain habits or blocks, sometimes learning about a past life and how that could be contributing to that block, to that negative part of you, to that weakness, can actually help you. And that's therefore the reason why that door opened up for us, because it can help. Everything we're learning today can help us instead of hurting us. Everything, every bit of information comes out for some reason. It's the way we put it together that could cause the problem. I'll leave it at that.
So it's okay. That's beautiful information to know about past lives and how they're connected to us. It's kind of almost like a shopping list of things that you can grab. Oh yeah, when I was in Egypt, I'll grab a little bit of this. Oh, when I was in Atlantis, I'll grab a little of this. When I was this, I'll grab a little bit of this.
Exactly.
And you kind of build your persona in this. It's part of the soul blueprint. So it's the soul planning when you're coming down here. That's what you're grabbing, because these are the things that you have experiences and so on. I could keep talking to you for another hour or two, Vincent, without question, but I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Living a fulfilled life is what makes you feel your worth, your value, that you're meaningful. And that could be a dream that you wind up fulfilling, right? That you are aspiring towards. But it makes you feel your wholeness as a magnificent divine being. And even if you don't recognize the divinity aspect of that, the fact that you feel whole, that you feel you lived your fullest, you almost can't answer that question without it begging the question and using part of the term in there. A fulfilled life is feeling full, right? But that's what makes it filling.
Fair enough.
And so, but it's feeling your wholeness and knowing that you're more than this physical body and person.
Now, if you had a chance to go back in time and speak to little Vincent, what advice would you give him?
Punch the first bully. It's just like, watch Back to the Future.
Just punch him in
punch
the nose.
The first bully that winds up picking on you, so you don't have to go through that. No, I would tell little Vinny, none of this and none of the negative experiences is your fault as a kid, that you are lovable. You are lovable and you are worthy and you are someone special, as everyone is. That's what I would tell him.
How do you define God or source?
Oh, that's easy. I believe, you see, I'm a panatheist. I believe that God is a power and is the force, just like in Star Wars. George Lucas was very metaphysical and inspirational. And because I actually worked with a producer that worked with him at his studios, and he created Star Wars as a story about us and our relationship with the God force. And each of the characters is another side of who we are, especially the major ones. Luke Skywalker and Anakin Skywalker are all parts of us and what we can become, and that we're meant to be Jedi Knights. So in that story, they talked about the Force as a power, but then they also talked about that the Metachurians were living beings that created the Force, that were the Force. So to me, that was George Lucas's way of defining God, that it is a force, but it also is a living being unto itself. It has a personality that you can talk with. I absolutely believe that. I don't believe that it's just a power and it's a universal thing and that we become part of it. No, we can have a relationship with it just like you and I can have a relationship. If we're created in its image and we have personalities, it has to have a personality. God and I talk all the time, and everybody can talk with God. I mean, I'm going to actually have Neil Donald Walsh on my podcast coming up in November and talking about his new book, God Talk, where he teaches everyone how to talk with God. So I believe that God is a power and a personality all combined, and that we are part of that whole package. But it has its own personality as we have our own individuality.
What is love?
What is love? The most ambiguous word. Love is defining it. Love is that feeling that lets you know that you're connected to something greater. Love is God. We are made of love, and we can experience it not only just for ourselves and about ourselves, but with each other. It is an experience that excites every single cell in your physical body, as well as raises your energy of your soul to a higher level. It is a power And it is a great power that creates great things. And you will always know it physically by the tingling sensation, or by the tears that you have coming down, or by the palpitations you get in your heart. And you will know it as an energy body because your energy will pulse the same way. But it is always the best feeling that there is to be defined at all on this planet or in all existence.
And what is the ultimate purpose of this life?
Oh, to get to know your, that's an easy question. To get to know your divinity and magnificence, to only experience what you already know, what's deep down inside, what you were given from the very beginning. You can never understand something until you experience it truly. So that's the purpose of this life, to experience our greatness.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
All you have to do is go to VincentGenna.com, and that's with a G-E-N-N-A, and you can connect with me there. Sign on to my podcast from there. Also purchase my book from there. Make an appointment with me. Connect with me on all social media platforms. So that's the best way to go, is VincentGenna.com. And I have to tell you right now, I need to get one of your hats, because Next Level Soul is the greatest name for your podcast and all the work that you do. And I got to promote that out there. So you got to give a link to your merchandise.
Oh, I appreciate that very much, my friend. And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Yeah, some of the hardest work you will ever do is working on healing yourself. It is easier to become a CEO of a major company than it is to heal all the scars, all the damage that you may have experienced from your youth until now. And I know everybody has some level of hurt and pain that they need to heal. But to go in there and to do the work, to disempower the defense mechanisms that get in the way of the truth of what you feel about yourself, because that's where manifesting occurs, in your unconscious level. Do the work. Bring to the surface what you're really believing, so you can change those internal beliefs to make the outer conscious beliefs now work for you, so that you can create the life that you want. And you can. The work is hard, but when you get on the other side of that work, it's like women having a baby. You know, there's 8 billion people on the face of the earth only because, believe it or not, women have a hormone that is secreted after they give birth that lets them forget the physical pain. They may remember the experience, but they will not and cannot relive that pain. Because if they did, there'd only be 3 people on the face of the earth right now. Okay? But it's the same thing with the work. When you get on the other side of the work, it's almost like a spiritual hormone is secreted, and you look back and you say, this was easy. When in fact, you did the greatest work you could ever do. Don't fail yourself. Just keep doing that work, and you will experience the greatest life you can. And that's a promise.
Vincent, this has been such a pleasure talking to you today. I think this episode is going to do a lot of good for a lot of people. I appreciate you and everything you're doing to awaken this planet, my friend. So thank you again.
Oh, my gosh. And the same, Alex. I could not get this message out there if there weren't people as wonderful as you. I consider you guys like a lighthouse. You're a big, giant lighthouse. And in the work that you're doing, obviously, Alex, you're reaching people, and so many of them, because you have found your path of what you were meant to really do. So now you're shining the light the right way, and bless you, man. And I wish you continued success, because the world needs you. And I know this is going to sound like a radical overstatement. It's not. You truly are the salvation of this world. And I appreciate you and am honored to be a guest on your show. I have been looking towards you, and just let you know, I've written, it never got to you, but I've written you many times, because I always wanted to be on this podcast, because I knew it would be reaching the right people if I was. And then lo and behold, the right time, I wind up hearing that Alex wants to have me on his podcast. And so to me, it's a blessing and an honor. And I want to thank you.
Appreciate you, my friend. Thank you again.
It's been fun.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.